Hello and welcome back to KubeCon Cloud Native Con London 2025. Rob Strecce, we're here getting through day three of our coverage wall to wall around everything that's been going on in the developer lifecycle to help people understand how do you make your life easier with all of the different projects and companies that are here exhibiting at KubeCon. And I'm really excited. I have Lucas Gentile. Did I say that properly?
That's perfect.
Awesome. Lucas Gentile, who's the co-founder and CEO of Loft Labs. Welcome to the show. And Andrew Hainsworth, principal platform engineer, Aussie Broadband, all the way over from Brisbane. So welcome onto the show here.
Thanks for having me.
So this is really cool because I dug into your stuff a little bit, really interesting things. But for those at home who don't know who Loft Labs are, kind of break down what you are and what are the different products that you bring to market.
Yeah, we're all about virtualizing Kubernetes and the cloud native stack. And with virtualizing, I don't mean VMs, I actually mean the opposite. Bare metal Kubernetes, for example, is a big case for us. What we allow you to do is spin up virtual Kubernetes clusters on top of traditional Kubernetes clusters, right? So kind of like a VM, but the Kubernetes way.
So it's really helping people maximize their hardware and their investment in that so that, because I mean, right now we see it, budgets are only going to grow worldwide by 3.5% this year. That's down from 4.5% that they did last year. So I think, again, when you start to look at this, it's really getting more out of that and doing it in a secure and safe way. Bring you in here, Andrew. You're using Loft Labs. You're using vCluster. Why? What has led you on this journey with them?
What a journey it's been. We embarked on our sort of container story probably only 2.5 years ago. I came into a team that was purely VMware, top to bottom, compute, storage, network, very, very traditional. And we decided to go with Kates as an orchestrator, started rolling it out on our bare metal infrastructure, converting VMware hypervisors to bare metal Kates. Subsequently, we had some challenges with multi-tenancy and how do we effectively partition these resources where we have a finite amount of bare metal. So my team and I, mostly my team, evaluated a number of ways of doing it. Namespace segregation with RBAC, which is quite clunky, and clusters on VMs, which is resource intensive, all those kernel copies. Other tools like Kiosk, and later looked into Kamaji as well, but suddenly we came onto vCluster and it just clicked.
Yeah.
Like the way it does what it does and the ease of deployment and the self-service options that came with it for our customers, it was just the way to go.
So you had some impressive, you also had some impressive results from this, because that to me was one of the things that stuck out when we caught up a little bit before. How much more efficient is this for you than your previous?
It's tremendous. We did a comparison recently on what would this cost us resource-wise to deploy the equivalent number of Kates clusters using VMs. Because we were looking at that from the perspective of what would VM licensing, VMware licensing look like compared to these other options. And it was somewhere in the order of 50 to 60% fewer sort of CPU cycles to achieve the same workloads. Hundreds of VMs saved. We're looking at 40 vClusters that we're running now, and they have a variable number of nodes, but say 5, 6, 7 per vCluster, hundreds of VMs, and terabytes of memory, really, that was saved.
So Lucas, kind of help us understand what a typical customer looks like when they engage with you guys and why they engage with you and things of that nature so that you can, really just, people understand the use case, I guess you could say.
Yeah, I think we have to differentiate between the public cloud and the private cloud, right? In the public cloud, it's really about how can I spin up clusters without spinning up more EKS or AKS clusters, right? They're all very expensive. There's a lot of duplication, right? You run all these tools like OPA, logging, monitoring, Prometheus, everything is duplicated in each cluster, right? So it's not just the cluster fee. It's also, you know, underutilization of nodes, right? Underutilization of things like Istio, OPA, all of these things, right? Consolidating things into fewer clusters and then having that virtual cluster layer on top that still allows you to do multi-tenancy, split things up into separate units is incredibly valuable. I think in the private cloud, the challenge is more, okay, we have all of these virtual machines. They consume a lot of CPU and memory. There's a license fee attached to it that is just going up and to the right, as we all know, right, recently. And, you know, customers just want to eliminate VMs, right? They want to go bare metal. They want to create, you know, one bare metal Kubernetes cluster, ideally. You know, maybe it's multiple data centers, so maybe you have five Kubernetes clusters, but you don't need 200, right? And then you want to spin up these virtual clusters dynamically on top. I think that's been a driver for a lot of folks. And then last but not least, GPU clouds, right? Like, not just CPU cases, but also GPUs is a really big driver because you don't want virtualization when you're working with GPUs, right? You want the bare metal performance. There's like about a, you know, 30, 40% overhead latency when you're using, you know, separate kernels virtualization, and getting rid of that with GPUs, like these, you know, pieces of hardware is so expensive. You want to get every little bit of efficiency out of them. That's what we can help you do.
And is that some of the direction that Aussie Broadband is going in? You're looking at this and saying, hey, this is how we get to the future of our infrastructure. Is that something you're seeing?
Do you mean in terms of
you're preparing,
adding GPUs?
Yeah, preparing for AI and AI use cases and stuff like that.
Well, obviously it's a big topic at the moment, and I think if you talk to some of the people in our organization, that they certainly have designs towards getting some of that, our own sort of inferencing and potentially LLMs on-prem,
right,
to deal with the data that we have, like, ourselves. I wouldn't say it's an absolutely primary consideration for the platform we're implementing now, but definitely it is in our minds that it might be something we'd like to do.
Yeah, yeah. And you're not alone, by the way. I did a panel for the Data on Kubernetes group on, what day was it? Wednesday. I got to, like, the days are all floating through my head here. And we asked the 600 people who were in the room how many were actually doing training versus inference, and it was like 10 people were doing training, or 10 organizations were doing training, and about 15 were doing inference. So I think what we see also in our data is a lot of people are experimenting with this, and one of the big places they're doing it is on things like a vCluster so that they can get efficiency and get standardization. Is that some of the stuff that you're also seeing in your customer base?
No, absolutely. I think if people are not looking into that trend and considering the use, you know, of GPUs and AI and building that kind of capability out, yeah, I think that then they'll probably be behind in a couple of years. So I think everybody's like looking into it. It's obviously early days still, right? And I think a lot of deployments may not be as efficient as they should be. But hopefully we can make a contribution, and especially with our, you know, KubeCon announcement here with vNode, I think that's another big contribution towards making, you know, GPU nodes and CPU nodes more efficient as well.
Yeah, let's dig into that, because again, that was actually where I was going to go next, is help people understand what that is and why it's important, and why, you know, things like kernel level and node level virtualization are really important for this type of thing.
Yeah, when you're thinking about multi-tenancy, right, we virtualize the Kubernetes control plane so you can spin up these Kubernetes clusters inside containers, right? But you're still going to have multiple Kubernetes clusters on the same underlying, you know, traditional cluster. And these virtual clusters are going to schedule inevitably pods on the same node, right? So you have shared nodes, and you know, if you're security conscious, right, or you want to prevent noisy neighbor problems, you want to shield against container breakouts, right, those are very pressing problems in multi-tenant environments. And so far, we've only been at the Kubernetes API layer with vCluster. Now we're going a level deeper and help you do that multi-tenancy in the right way without virtual machines, right? Like there's these approaches like Kata container, right? VMs and VMs or micro VMs, right? These kinds of approaches. There's gVisor, which is SecComm filtering. And you know, all of them have their downsides and you know, they have a lot of loss of efficiency, performance issues, latency, right? So we decided to build our own technology because we've seen our customers struggle with these technologies and we want to bring it to more people ultimately.
Yeah. Let's kind of dive in a little bit on the isolation thing because and you talked about breakouts and I think that's gotten a lot of press recently.
Yeah.
People looking at more, you know, people go where the data is, they go and they're looking at this and they're going, people are building you know, inference on you know, Kubernetes. If we can get in there and we can hop out and get to the node out of the container, then we can get across the entire cluster. Is that what your, like a lot of your customers' feedback has been and drove you in this direction?
Yeah, absolutely. We've seen customers, you know, do, you know, virtual clusters at scale, but then separate out the nodes for exactly that reason, right? We've seen customers restrict their tenants really hard, you know. Let's say if you want to do image building in a container, you know, you want to have a development container, you want Docker in there, obviously, right? The question is, how do you do it without a privileged container? Because all of these things need to run as root, typically. Shared environment, you don't want to enable anyone to get these kind of capabilities, right? With vNode, we wrap all of these pods on the same node into a virtual node. And you know, my co-founder and CTO, Fabian, he has this really cool demo that he runs. It is, you know, he runs a container breakout. He emulates container breakout. And then he's like, oh, we're on the node now. Oh, we're actually not, we're just on the virtual node, right? You're still stuck in that virtual node.
Right.
It's very impressive. And I think, yeah, we should probably go back and, you know, look at the latest container breakout CVEs over the past year and just try to emulate them with vNode.
Yeah, that would be a very cool demo, to put it mildly. It's great. So, Andrew, platform engineering has been all the talk this week. I went to Platform Engineering Day on Tuesday. A lot of it was around how to simplify platform engineering and how to kind of meet in the middle with devs and security. How do you see that and how does like your vClusters really help you actually help from an organizational perspective at Aussie Broadband? I'll get that right one of these times.
Ooh, gosh. I don't really think
I know
that,
I put
that,
you on the
yeah,
spot.
Yeah, that's not
here.
A question I've been asked before. But it's absolutely simplified the provisioning element, and I think it's given some of our developer teams who have wanted to get into containerizing our applications and move in that direction, it's increased their confidence in their ability and our ability as the platform to deliver, and having that self-service capability that the vCluster platform has provided has drastically reduced the amount of time that we need to spend sort of holding their hands and that kind of thing. Of course, I don't mean that in a bad way.
Right. No, I mean, but I think that's true because people want to be self-service. Developers don't want to have to put in a ticket and go and open up things all the time. They want templates, they want things and keep, they actually want guardrails in a lot of times. They
and
want some amount of choice.
That's a big thing.
Yeah, and has that helped you?
Absolutely, so with Loft and Loft Labs and vCluster, we have a concept of an ephemeral Kates cluster. So part of their pipelines can actually be creating a Kates cluster from scratch, deploying their application on it, doing their tests, and destroying that Kates cluster in an hour. And that's just sort of unachievable with a lot of the other methods. Or if it is achievable, it's not as efficient or more clunky, more licensing implications, and so I think from the security perspective, we're still at odds with security in some ways, but Yeah,
but it's getting better.
It's getting much better.
And that's a very normal story. I think, again, it's I call it meat in the middle because, you know, again, people want to bring security and bring developers and bring that all together. And platform engineering ends up being in the middle of all of that and trying to bring all of that together. Well, Lucas and Andrew, thank you for coming on board. This has really been a lot of fun. This is something that's near and dear to my heart. So, glad to have you here on theCUBE.
Thanks for having us.
And thank you for watching this segment here live from KubeCon, Cloud Native Con, London 2025 on theCUBE, the leader in tech news and analysis. We'll be right back.